We tend to see jelly today as something that's reserved for kiddies' parties. We certainly don't really consider it on a day-to-day level, gastronomic. The Victorians, for them, this is one of the most impressive things you could serve. Jelly.
I want to capture the Victorians' love affair with jelly for my feast.
I'm on my way to an architectural jelly banquet.
This is the perfect place for me to discover jelly's hidden past.
It's sort of one of the ultimate narf-narf foods. It's the idea when you put this jelly down and see the whole thing wobbling and everyone around the table going...
Harry Parr is the event's organiser.
Have you got any information about the Victorians' love for jelly?
The Victorians used to put jellies down the centre of their tables and then they would watch them wobble and that would be a form of amusement during the meal.
like titillation?
Yeah, exactly. Of course, jelly was... it was very hard to make jelly because you needed to make the gelatin, so it was such a noble dessert.
Big-name architects like Sir Richard Rogers, Sir Norman Foster and Nicholas Grimshaw have all designed jellies for the festival, and it makes me think that there's still a special relationship between the British people and their jelly.
If you had to have the perfect jelly, what would it be?
A tree. Like, the trunk of one kind of jelly and the leaves a different kind of jelly.
That's cool. OK, I've just got to make these, which is going to be a bit difficult. I love the hat, though.
Thank you. Yes, it's the jelly hard hat.
That's fantastic. Is that actually made with...
It is. Wine gums.
That's fantastic.
Well, not only does it provide for sight safety, but if you feel a bit hypoglycemic, you can just bite the rim off as well.
The essence of the ceiling's really been this combination of the seriousness of the architectural approach to constructing a jelly, which is put into a couple of hundred tiny little jellies on the table up there. And there's over 1,000 people here being really rather silly. It's great. I mean, maybe that's the essence of jelly. It brings out the kid in all of us. Jockey, we're losing him.
Bring him back.
And you. No, see, we can't push any of these in the gel.
No.
It's just going to snap. It won't work. We're going to try one with a hole in the plate. But if we could try putting a jelly on top of that, hold the plate and then you put that on.
That feels so wrong when you do it. There might be more.
It's that
cone shape
there. Right? Can you see hear it hitting the plate? We need something that oscillates slower, actually more pronounced movement. Because I think that.
What about this?
Okay.
Oh, God.
This is called Mini Tongue by Lady Colston because she can. So, if you hold that. Now we're
That's
talking.
That's slow,
isn't it? Oh! Go fast.
Here we go. That's it. We're on full speed, yeah.
I think we might have got it.
You cracked it.
I think we found it.
Well then.
I've got my jelly to wobble, but to make a truly spectacular pudding, I need to venture deep into the Victorian psyche to find one of the most deadly substances of the time, absinthe. But its taste is a problem. So if I'm to use it in my Victorian jelly, I need a way to overcome this.
This was the problem, the absinthe. This was and should be an essential part of this jelly course, but to make an absinthe jelly on its own, I just didn't think it tasted very nice. So being able to actually incorporate that into something which tasted delicious, it was really touch and go, actually. We scraped in with this recipe last minute. So this is how I've sold it. Strawberry juice in here. To that, I'm going to add another very British summertime Victorian ingredient, elderflower. And then the green fairy. Highly scientific.
What's happening is that the strawberry and elderflower sweetness is helping to complement and control the aniseed strength of the absinthe.
We now need to put the setting agent into the jelly. So we're going to put this frozen cream into the gel. So the idea is when they cut into the jelly, the cream will run out. That's ready. So these are my individual portions, but in Victorian times, jelly was a spectacle. So we need a spectacle. That is going to be my adult birthday party jelly. And to add an extra dimension, we've put in some luminescence. So if this works, the jelly is going to literally glow in the dark.
The problem with making a giant jelly is that we've no way of knowing if it's worked until we turn it out.
Ready?
Spring her down.
Okay.
No miniature.
Please take me off. We've now got to get this onto this little baby here. This is our wobble box.
I've taken the mechanism from the vibrating tongues and positioned them to wobble my jelly table. And one final touch.
I've got these. The idea. So here we have a wibbly, wobbly, glowy, Absinthe jelly.
That's amazing.
It's a Victorian homage to titillation and absinthe.
Is it in the jelly?
Yes.
Oh, oh.
It's also in the balloon.
For another hit of the Green Fairy, I've added absinthe to a balloon along with another Victorian discovery, helium.
Oh my God.
Hello.
This is definitely the Mad Hatter's teapot.
This is Maggie Emma reporting from somewhere deep in North London. And it feels very, very good.
I don't think these were invented in the Victorian era.
Yes, they were actually.
Were they?
Doctors used to masturbate women on a regular basis because it was believed that women suffered from a disease called hysteria.
Masturbation to cure hysteria? Wowza.
And no jelly would be complete without ice cream, made with two of my favourite Victorian inventions, liquid nitrogen and Earl Grey tea.
It's a Mr. Whippy.
Then for my absinthe jelly. Aww.
Strawberry and jasmine jelly with a bit of a kick, and the kick is absinthe. Isn't it hallucinogenic?
It kind of felt like you just discovered food again for the first time, like it was like going to your first kid's party and going, there's just so much to have, and there's so many pretty things.
I felt like we have actually fallen through the hole, eaten the biscuit, shrunk, grown small. I think we've done all of that, you know, and suddenly we've woken up on the other side. It was a real adventure.
I sort of describe it as the Victorian era with magic mushrooms and turbo boosters. That's the way you've got to sort of imagine it, the way that he's done it.
I wanted my guests to